I first had the opportunity to hear Heather Zwicky speak on a Parkinson's Disease Foundation webinar in September of 2015, and then again at the World Parkinson Congress that Sarah and I attended in Portland last September, September of 16. And if any of you have taken the PD1, you may know the slide that I go over that says you may not have had control over getting Parkinson's, but you definitely have some control over how well you live with it. Back in the early 1900s, I was reading this quote by Thomas Edison, who predicted that the doctor of the future will give no medicine, but will instruct his or her patient in the care of the human frame and diet, and in causes and prevention of diseases. That was in 1903. We're not quite there yet, but we're getting closer. And I think today's program is an effort to do just that. Whatever genes we may have inherited from our parents, and what we eat can affect how those genes affect our health. The power is mainly in our hands and on your plates. So eating healthier is easier than you think, and it just might save your life. There's growing research showing that nutrition has an impact on Parkinson's. Dr. Zwicky will identify foods that are thought to benefit or harm people with Parkinson's and why they have those effects. She will suggest practical ways to incorporate lessons from nutrition research into your daily routines to help you live longer, healthier lives, and that's what we want you to do. Dr. Heather Zwicky is Dean of Research and Graduate Studies at the National University of Natural Medicine, Director of HealthGut Research Institute, and a professor of immunology. She trained at the world-renowned National Jewish Medical and Research Center in Denver. She earned a PhD in immunology and microbiology, you're not a sluffer, I guess, from the University of Colorado Health Sciences Center, and went on to complete a postdoctoral fellowship and teach medical school at Yale University. So you know she knows her stuff. At HealthGut Research Institute, Dr. Zwicky applies her immunology expertise to natural medicine. She studies the immunological and neurological mechanisms that are involved in nutrition, herbal medicine, acupuncture, and mind-body therapies. She studies nutrition and Parkinson's disease and has a particular interest in how inflammation impacts the brain-gut axis. So please, if you would, welcome Dr. Heather Zwicky.
So I keep saying good morning to people. I'm coming to you from Portland, Oregon. So a little bit off on the time zones, but I will do my best here. As Debbie mentioned, I am from the National University of Natural Medicine, and most people have never heard of the National University of Natural Medicine. Would you agree with that? Yeah. When I went there from Yale, my mom said it was career suicide. But the reality was, I was really interested in nutrition, and I had been teaching medical school at Yale, and before that I taught at University of Colorado, and the physicians got 3 hours of nutrition for their entire medical training. So was it any wonder that the advice that they would give to patients was, eat healthy, and then they'd let it go at that? Well, what the heck does that mean? Eat healthy. Like, we don't even know. There's all these nutrition studies coming out. Some say chocolate is good for you. Some say chocolate is bad for you. Which is it? Whichever supports our worldview? I don't know. So my mom was on the hospital board at Mayo. I grew up in Minnesota, just up the river from you. And I decided that I was going to follow the course of medicine that kind of met what I believed in. So I've been studying now for 15 years. Nutrition and its impact on the body. And I'm going to try to convey some of that knowledge to you today. So, as I said, I'm at the National University of Natural Medicine, and I have to disclose I do have a supplement company that I recently started, but I'm not going to talk about supplements today. And I also am funded by the National Institutes of Health. So I train researchers in how to do good natural medicine research. So my first question for you is, does nutrition affect the brain? Good, you passed the first level. Awesome. And you've already bypassed what most neurologists know about nutrition. So, and I don't mean that disparagingly. I just mean that when I talk to neurologists, they say, oh, no, it really doesn't have a whole lot to do with it. But yeah, absolutely it does. It absolutely does. On the other hand, we also know that food is fuel. And so food is impacting every system in your body, not just your brain. Every once in a while, this goes in and out. I'm sorry about that. It doesn't just impact your brain. It impacts every system. So just like you have to put good fuel in your car, you have to put good fuel in your body. And when I say good fuel, what I mean is nutrient-dense fuel. So we'll talk about what those nutrients are. But we have a little bit of a complication when we start talking about nutrition, and that is that it's not just fuel. Food is also something that we revolve our lives around. So we have birthday parties to celebrate things. We celebrate with feasts at Thanksgiving and at Christmas. And everybody has what I call their food story. What do I mean when I say you have a food story? I mean that there are certain foods that mean something to you. Maybe it's that every Sunday you have pizza with your grandchildren. And so if I tell you to stop eating pizza, do you think you're going to do it? No, not if it's going to impact your relationship with your grandchildren. And maybe it's that you go out to eat with your partner and you guys drink a lot of beer. Now, if I tell you you can't have beer, is that going to impact your relationship with your partner? I hope not, but it could. And so one of the things we have to do when we make changes with respect to nutrition is we have to look at the people around us and see how it's going to impact our relationships with them as well. And I know, and all of you know, that you're not going to make an impact to your diet without impacting your partner. Sometimes it's even your partner who's doing the cooking. So it has to involve them, right? So it's not so easy to make changes to diet. And as a result of that, we see that the nutrition studies that we do are really difficult. What do I mean? Well, usually when you do scientific research, what you want to do is what's called a randomized controlled trial. You want it double blind, meaning that the doctor and the patient don't know what the person is doing to see if that's going to impact their health. Boy, if I feed you something, are you blind to what you're eating? No. So we can't blind nutrition studies. Okay, well, can we blind the person who's feeding you? No, can't do that either. How about if we randomize you? And we say, well, you get randomly selected to eat spinach salads, and you get randomly selected to eat corn dogs. You think anybody wants to be a part of that study? Only the ones randomized to the corn dogs, right? So it's really hard to randomize people to nutrition studies as well. So what we see is that there's not a lot of nutrition research out there that meet that gold standard of randomized controlled trials. There's a few, but there's not a lot. Instead, what we see are what's called epidemiological studies. Epidemiological studies are studies where we follow people and we look at what they're doing already and we see what their health outcomes are. So we might say, in the case of Parkinson's, we might say, oh, look, everybody who's drinking green tea has really good outcomes with their Parkinson's, and they do. But who's drinking green tea? Maybe the people who are drinking green tea are the same people who are also exercising more. Or maybe the people who are drinking green tea happen to eat a whole lot of Japanese food, and it's Japanese food and not the green tea that's having an effect on their Parkinson's. So when we do epidemiological studies and it's not randomized, we don't know what other things people are doing to have an impact on their health. So it gives us some answers, but it doesn't give us all the answers. We have other kinds of nutrition studies that are out there. We have studies where we study one ingredient. So you'll see studies where they say blueberries are good for Parkinson's. Cool. Do you think that we just ground up blueberries and gave them to people with Parkinson's for 3 weeks and then looked at their outcomes and they didn't eat anything else? That'd be pretty boring, wouldn't it? Who'd want to be in that study? Right, so instead, When they say blueberries are good for Parkinson's, they're adding it on top of something else. Now, they might be adding it onto a diet where people eat a good home-cooked meal 7 days a week. Or they might be adding it to a diet where people eat at McDonald's 7 days a week. Gonna have a different impact? Absolutely. So when we see these single ingredient studies, we also have to ask those questions of like, well, what was the single ingredient combined with? And then we have animal studies. And animal studies are even more complex because think about this. I used to work in the lab, worked in the lab for a long time. What do you think that mice in the lab eat? Purina mouse chow. That's what we feed them. So now if I feed them human food and I look at the impact, is it the same as it's going to be on you? Absolutely not. You have a very diverse diet compared to Purina mouse chow. So interpreting the results of all of our nutrition studies, of looking at single ingredients when you eat a whole diet, and looking what happens in a mouse when you don't have the same digestive system as a mouse, of looking at epidemiological studies, like all of those things, they're not ideal, but we make the best conclusions that we can. And that's what I'm going to show you today, is the best conclusions that are out there so far based on the level of evidence that is available right now. Some of it may really ring true for you, and some of it might not, because this isn't the best quality evidence, but it's what we've got to work with. So that's what we're going to do today. Here is our strategy. Our strategy when dealing with Parkinson's is threefold. The first thing that we want to do is we want to increase what I call brain food. This is food that has positive effects on the brain. So we're going to increase things that are going to have good positive effects on the brain. That's strategy one. Strategy two is we are going to decrease inflammation. So whether you're aware of it or not, neuroinflammation is what causes the progression of Parkinson's. So there's an inflammatory response that happens in the brain that causes more and more damage, and we want to reduce that response. When we reduce inflammation systemically, we reduce the inflammation in the brain. So we're going to do that, and we can do that with food, as it turns out. And our third strategy is that we want to reduce chemicals. And we want to reduce chemicals because the research is starting to really very positively show that chemicals are involved in the development and progression of Parkinson's. Specifically chemicals that are pesticides and herbicides. So if we can get those out of our diet, we're going to do that. So that's going to be our threefold strategy, and we're going to see how that impacts all of these other areas. Increase brain food, decrease inflammation, decrease chemicals in the diet. Okay, why? Why do we think nutrition is going to impact Parkinson's? Well, Parkinson's affects not just the brain. Parkinson's actually affects the whole body. We see systemic inflammation with Parkinson's. We see oxidative stress. That might be a new phrase for you, oxidative stress. You might have heard of that called free radicals before. So free radicals and oxidative stress, that's the same thing. So we think about free radicals and it damages our skin and makes our cells age. That's what oxidative stress does. And Parkinson's definitely has that by the boatload. And then we also see blood glucose misregulation in Parkinson's. That's a new one for some people. Blood glucose misregulation, we think of diabetes. But it turns out that people are starting to call Parkinson's and Alzheimer's type 3 diabetes because there's a blood glucose misregulation that happens in it. So we need to think about blood glucose. Now, if we're thinking about nutrition, nutrition affects the whole body, so that's a good match. It also affects neuronal health. Great, we can deal with that. Nutrition impacts systemic inflammation. It impacts oxidative stress, those free radicals. It can lower your blood glucose. And nutrition has the added benefit of having an effect on your microflora. That might be another new term for you. So a lot of commercials now showing Jamie Lee Curtis and other people eating yogurt and having an effect on their microflora. So when I say microflora, I'm talking about the bacteria in your belly. Okay, we call that microflora. It's the microbes that are in your gut. Turns out there's more microbes in your gut than there are cells in your entire body. So what you feed them makes a difference because they impact every part of your body. So we need to pay attention to what's going on with the microflora. And then chemical toxicity can be addressed by nutrition as well. So we're going to talk about that. Now, we all know that Parkinson's doesn't just have one kind of symptom. There are the motor symptoms and there are the non-motor symptoms. And it turns out nutrition affects both. We're going to separate them out because the mechanisms are different for the motor symptoms versus the non-motor symptoms. Okay, are you ready? So we got our strategy. Strategy is increase brain food, decrease inflammation, decrease chemicals. Here we go. The motor symptoms we're going to start with are bradykinesia, gait, and restless leg syndrome. So we're going to think about foods that affect these various motor symptoms. Now, there are other motor symptoms, and it turns, and we'll talk about some of them anyway. It turns out that nutrition will impact those as well. But these are the three big ones that we have good studies that say nutrition can impact bradykinesia, gait, and restless leg syndrome. So bradykinesia, slowness. What has an impact on bradykinesia? Berries. Cool, huh? You got berries around here. You got a lot of berries around here. Turns out berries contain a chemical called anthocyanins. Anthocyan. Cyan is blue, right? And anthocyanins is the bluish red color that you get in berries. The darker the berry, the better it is for your brain. So if I give you strawberries, raspberries, blackberries, and blueberries, which one's the best? Blackberries, right, absolutely. So anthocyanins are good for your brain, and you can remember that. And so when you're in the health food store or you're in the grocery store, the darker the color, you pull that. Same is true for berry juices. So think about like pomegranate juice, super dark, go for that. When you get to the juices, now you have sugar content to think about, right? And so I'd rather have you have whole berries than have the juice of the berry. But if you don't have a choice, go for the juice. The juice still has the antioxidants and it still has the anthocyanins in it. The other thing that's really good for bradykinesia is a mineral called selenium. And selenium happens to be highest in Brazil nuts. Now, I don't want you to eat a lot of Brazil nuts. I want you to eat one or two Brazil nuts a day. Why don't I want you to eat a lot of Brazil nuts? There was some research that came out a couple of years ago that suggested that high doses of Brazil nuts, like 15 nuts a day, had an effect on prostate cancer. So one or two Brazil nuts a day, that's good for selenium. The other places to get selenium is crab, poultry, and fish. So if you're eating trout, that's a good way to get selenium, and you don't have to eat the Brazil nuts. Same thing is true, though. Not too much selenium. Don't go down in the trout all the time. All right, next thing, tremor. There's no research on Parkinson's-specific tremor. However, there is research on essential tremor. And what's been shown for tremor is that cannabinoids reduce tremor. So medical marijuana. And I know that it's not yet legal in Missouri, is that correct? Yeah, so sorry about that. It's legal in Oregon, and we definitely see an impact on tremor. But the other thing that will impact tremor is vitamin B12. And here's the thing, if you actually look at a nutrient panel for people with Parkinson's, their B12 tends to be very low. L-DOPA will also reduce B6. So again, if you're on an L-DOPA drug, you want to check your B6 levels because you want B6 and B12 to be normal. And often they're low in people with Parkinson's. And that will impact tremor. Oh, I went back to the beginning. That's okay. Okay, what about coffee? I get coffee a lot. Especially in the Midwest, we love our coffee, don't we? Coffee's good for Parkinson's. In fact, coffee is good for every disease, as it turns out, except cancer. There have been two huge studies, one of 265,000 people and another one of 400,000 people, looking at coffee on what we call all-cause mortality, how you die, the effects of coffee on how you die. And it turns out for everything but cancer, coffee reduces mortality. And it's dose dependent. So one cup is good, two cups are better, three cups are better, up to six cups a day. Woohoo! Reason to celebrate, right? Now, you notice I said coffee. I did not say Starbucks. Why did I not say Starbucks? Uh-huh, exactly. I'm not talking about caramel macchiatos. I'm talking about coffee. The research was done on coffee. And the reason that the research was done on coffee and not caramel macchiatos is sugar is, and we will get there, sugar is not good for you. The coffee actually is. There's two ingredients that we think have an impact on Parkinson's from coffee. The first one is caffeine. So the caffeine is actually what's good for you. Next question is, does that mean decaf is not as good? That is correct. Decaf does not have the same impact on disease as caffeinated coffee. The second thing is that coffee contains an ingredient called quercetin. And quercetin is an antioxidant. And that antioxidant is really good for your brain. Now, here's what I hear from other people with PD. I hear, well, yeah, coffee might be good for my brain, but then I have to pee all the time, and getting to the bathroom sucks, so it's not good for me. And that may be true. You have to balance the benefit with the harm, right? So if that's not your thing, or I hear from other people that coffee might be good for my brain, but it's really bad for my tremor, it actually makes my tremor worse, then don't do the coffee. Because it turns out that another thing that's really good for you is green tea, as I mentioned up front. So the research on green tea is actually really interesting. Research on green tea, these are, again, large epidemiological studies where this data is coming from. But it shows it can ward off Parkinson's for up to 7 years. That's really good. That's better than some of the drugs. So how much green tea are we talking about? We're talking about 3 cups a day. 3 cups a day of green tea. Why does it work like that? Well, the first thing is it does have in it an antioxidant. And remember, oxidative stress is one of those things we're trying to take care of. It reduces oxidation. But green tea also has a second property that we think is really good for Parkinson's. And that's that it is what's called a chelator. Chelator is spelled C-H-E-L-A-T-O-R, chelator. It removes metals from the body. Chelation is removing metals from the body. And it turns out that that's something that people with PD typically cannot do as efficiently as others. So if you drink green tea, I almost said eat green tea, because I got to tell you, I'm not a green tea fan myself for drinking it. So the way I deal with green tea, because I won't make a recommendation unless it's something I'm willing to do myself, I make green tea pesto. So you can buy dried green tea, it's called matcha, and I just put it into pesto and I put it on pasta. And then it tastes really good and then I'll have green tea. Or I'll put it in a smoothie where I can hide it behind chocolate. That one works really well too. So you don't have to drink it, you can always put it into a food. Since we're on beverages, let's talk about alcohol. If you're going to drink wine, red wine or white wine? Red, that's right. Red wine has the anthocyanins in it. Now, what I will remind you is that red wine tends to have very high levels of pesticides. So if you're going to drink red wine, I encourage you to find organic red wine if you can. Or if you know the farmer, and you may, ask them not to use pesticides so that you can drink their red wine. But if your choice is between red and white, go for red wine. What about beer? Think beer is good for Parkinson's? There's actually one study that came out in 2015 that said beer is good for Parkinson's. So there it is. There's only one. There's not more than one. I don't know if it's going to be shown to be wrong. But it, there was a study actually that came out of China that showed the mechanism for why we think beer is good for Parkinson's. And it actually has to do with some of the genes it turns on. It's not an immunological reason at all. It actually has to do more with the mitochondria for why they think beer might be good for Parkinson's. Okay, let's talk about some environmental toxicity. This tends to be a pretty big issue. So we know that Parkinson's has a genetic component, but we also know that we think the genetic component is about 10% of the disease. So 10% genetic, and then we modify those genes with the environment, with everything we do, with our exercise routine, with our sleep, etc., and with everything we eat, and with all the chemicals we're exposed to. So we have to be aware of our chemical burden. Now, where are the chemicals coming from? They're coming from pesticides. They're coming from polychlorinated biphenyls and solvents and metals and air pollutants. I'm in Portland. I didn't realize how much air pollution we get from China, because the clouds just blow right over the Pacific and they rain on our vegetables. And we're now finding large lead content in our kale. We thought our kale was healthy, and it turns out there's lead on the leaves because it's getting rained on. So it's not always something you can control, but we have to be aware that it's there. So the first thing is pesticides. And pesticides tend to show up in our GMO foods, but they also tend to show up just in our gardening. So, you know, if we can reduce the amount of pesticides that we're using at home, that right there helps the impact. But why do I even care about pesticides? There was a really interesting study. There's a couple reasons, by the way. This is just one of them. There was this really interesting study that came out in 2015 that was looking at that microflora in your gut that we were talking about. So one of the strains of microflora, one of the bacteria that lives in your gut, is called Prevotella. Prevotella. Here's what they showed. They showed that people with Parkinson's were missing their Prevotella. They had 77% less Prevotella than healthy people. And when the Prevotella died, it was replaced with E. coli in the gut. So, because your gut isn't going to leave big wide open spaces, right? So something else is going to grow to fill in. And so what happened is E. coli grew to fill in where the Prevotella was missing. What killed the Prevotella? Pesticides. Pesticides were killing the Prevotella, and then the E. coli overgrow. Now, here's what's really interesting about that. It turns out, and this is again dose dependent, the more E. coli you have, the worse your gait is. So the symptom of gait is directly related to the Prevotella to E. coli ratio in your gut. And we can control that with antibiotics as well. So if we kill the E. coli and the Prevotella starts to regrow, then the gait gets better. Interesting, huh? Who would have thought that a little microflora in your gut was impacting how well you walked? I wouldn't have thought that. And yet there it is. Now, it's more complicated than that, because usually when we think about replacing our gut bacteria, we think about things like yogurt or maybe taking a probiotic. The problem is Prevotella is what's called an anaerobic bacteria. It means it doesn't grow in the air. Air kills it. If air kills it, I can't give it to you as a probiotic. Instead, the only way that you get it is if you feed it real food. And the food that Prevotella likes tends to be things like leeks, artichokes, onions, those fibrous vegetables. That's what Prevotella likes. What's been shown is that if you don't have any Prevotella at all, you first have to seed your gut with broths, meat broths. So you might, you know, do what we do here in the Midwest and make a chicken soup and use the whole chicken, right? And get some seeded Prevotella culture is going to come from that whole chicken, and then do the onions and the leeks and the artichokes. So lots more research is coming out on this now. They're showing that some of the pesticides and herbicides will cause more of the different strains of microflora to die. And they're finding that some strains of pesticides and herbicides actually cause an increase in the growth of the E. coli. So again, it's a good reason why we should try to avoid those chemicals. The other reason that we think these chemicals are pretty harmful is that we do heat maps of where Parkinson's is most prevalent. And the most prevalent area for Parkinson's is Central California, where we have the huge growing belt of vegetables. And we see that that has the highest incidence of Parkinson's. So again, it's associated with the crop spraying that happens there. Okay, so let's talk about some practical ways then to think about these chemicals and getting them out of our diet. There's a group called EWG that every year publishes what's called the Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15. The Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15. The Dirty Dozen are the fruits and vegetables that have the most pesticides per year. Okay? And the Clean 15 are the fruits and vegetables that have the least pesticides per year. So what I'm presenting right now, and I know a lot of you can't see the slide, so I'm going to read it for you, but I'm presenting what was the Dirty Dozen for 2016, because the 2017 list just came out. It's not on my slide yet. But for 2016, the Dirty Dozen was apples, peaches, nectarines, strawberries, grapes, celeries, spinach, sweet bell peppers, cucumbers, cherry tomatoes, snap peas, potatoes, hot peppers, and kale collard greens. What does that mean? For the Dirty Dozen, those are the foods that you want to buy organic. Now, buying organic, you think could be expensive, but I've been to Walmart and they have organic food and it's not that expensive. It might add a couple of cents, but not too much. So if you get a chance to buy these foods organic, do it. How in the heck are you going to remember these foods? Here's the easy trick. If you eat the skin, buy it organic. If you don't eat the skin, if you peel it, then you can get away with conventional. So let's look at the Clean 15. Avocados, we peel it. Sweet corn, we peel it. Cabbage, we take the prickly part off. Pineapples, sorry. Sweet peas, onions, we peel them. Asparagus, we don't peel those, but we don't seem to see pesticides on those. Mangoes, papaya, kiwi, eggplant, grapefruit, cantaloupe, cauliflower, and sweet potato. In general, if you're not eating the outside, you don't have to peel it, and that you can buy conventional. I'll tell you another little trick that I do. You ever had lemon in your water? Yeah. And you take the lemon and then you just drop the whole thing in your water? Yeah, no, no. Because is that lemon organic? Probably not. And so what you've just done is you've allowed all the pesticides on the outside of that lemon to now leach into your water. So if you're going to have lemon in your water, squeeze the lemon into your water and then leave the rind out on the table. It might look disgusting, but it's way healthier for you. Same with cucumber. If you're going to put it in water, take the peeling off the cucumber and then put it in the water. But don't let the pesticides just leach into your water. If you're going to wash, so I get this question a lot too. What if I just wash my vegetables? That'll work, right? If you're going to wash and you wash really well with white vinegar, you can get a lot of the pesticide off the skin, as long as it hasn't leached into the fruit. And we think that it's not. All those tests are still being worked out, but we think that most of the pesticide stays on the skin. So you could wash with white vinegar to try to get any pesticide or herbicide off. That brings us to dairy. This one makes me exceedingly unpopular. I try not to take it personally, but I have to tell you that you need to limit your dairy. You probably should cut your dairy out entirely. Okay, why? Why am I telling you to stay away from dairy? Let's think about what dairy is. Dairy is a mama cow eating stuff to feed it to a baby cow. And everything mama cow eats, she concentrates into her milk to feed into the baby cow. And so if mama cow is eating pesticides and herbicides, it goes right into the dairy. And we've known since the 1960s that dairy was our most polluted food that we have in this country. And we haven't figured out a good way to unpollute our dairy. Yes, there is organic dairy, and that is better, but there's a second reason that we don't like dairy for Parkinson's, and that is dairy breaks down a chemical in your body called uric acid. Uric acid is protective for Parkinson's. Now, you might have heard of uric acid before, because uric acid is what builds up in your body when you get gout. You've ever heard of gout? You think of the big toes, swollen, red. That's too much uric acid. So if you have uric acid buildup, then yeah, by all means, eat some dairy. Dairy will break it down. But if you don't have uric acid buildup, I don't want you to remove uric acid from your body because it's really protective. In fact, one of the new drugs that's coming out for Parkinson's is a uric acid drug. We want you to have uric acid as much as you can. It is so protective, and dairy breaks it down. So no dairy. I know, I'm saying this in cow country. I know, I said it to my mother, and my mother was like, are you kidding me? No dairy? Yes, that means no cheese. That means no yogurt. I know. And worst of all, it means no ice cream. See, I told you I was going to be unpopular. I know. And here's where one of those things that comes into play that I talked about earlier, your food story might have an impact. I'll tell you what I mean. So I talk to my mom on a regular basis. She still lives in Minnesota, and she has really severe arthritis. And I say, you know, Mom, if you eliminated sugar, it would really help your arthritis. And she says, yeah, I know. And then she'll call me and she'll say, I went on a diet and I have had no sugar for a month. Really? I said, you give up your Ben and Jerry's that you had every night before bed? And she said, well, no, that's my calcium. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's part of her food story. She's not giving up her Ben and Jerry's. But she doesn't have Parkinson's either. And I would get a little bit more adamant if she did. Now, can you really have no ice cream? Well, what the research says is that up to 4 ounces a day is probably not detrimental. What is 4 ounces? 4 ounces is like 2 little butter packs, right? That's not a lot of ice cream. But maybe you save up your 4 ounces and you have ice cream only on Saturday night, right? Or here's some other ideas. They now make ice cream out of coconut milk. And they make ice cream out of soy milk. And soy and coconut are actually protective for Parkinson's. So if you can go for the coconut bliss ice cream, or you can go for the soy milk ice cream, you're actually doing some good for your brain. Here's another idea. There are lots of people who make their own ice cream now. And they make it out of nut milks, they make it out of frozen bananas, they make it out of avocado. I know avocado sounds disgusting, but it turns out it makes it really creamy. And you don't actually taste the avocado. So you might experiment with your own recipes for ice cream. And I didn't say you couldn't have chocolate. I'm trying to get back in your good graces now. You can have chocolate. But I want you to have dark chocolate. Right? Dark chocolate. Milk chocolate? Milk chocolate? No. Dark chocolate. Yes. So what do I mean when I say dark chocolate? I'm saying 72% cacao or more. I know, some of you are like gagging right now. But, you know, it's not horrible. Dark chocolate is good. And actually, dark chocolate is an antioxidant. It's really good for your brain. Do you know how long we've known that? My grandma was the head cook for Minneapolis Public Schools, and she read about dark chocolate in Reader's Digest in 1953. And she swore by dark chocolate. And it's true. It's really good for your brain. It's super good for memory. The dark chocolate, because it has less sugar in it, and it has that high antioxidant effect. All right, let's go back to our environmental toxicity. There's two minerals that we worry about with Parkinson's that we see imbalanced in Parkinson's. The first one is lithium. We see that people with Parkinson's either have too low or too high lithium. Usually it's too low. And usually where you see that is in places where a lot of industrial work has happened, and it gets leached from the soil. Now, really easy way to increase your lithium? Pistachios. Yeah, see, you like those. Woohoo! Now we've got dark chocolate and pistachios. The other one is manganese. And a lot of times people with Parkinson's will have excess manganese. They'll have excess manganese. And you know what the symptoms of excess manganese are? Rigidity, bradykinesia, and gait disturbance. It's affecting the microflora. How do you get rid of excess manganese? Green tea. Chelate it. Get it out of your body. Cool. So usually you won't have to supplement with manganese because usually it's too high, not too low. The other thing we worry about with environmental toxicity with metals is some of the fishes that are out there. Mackerel, for example, shark, some tunas will have mercury in them. And the other thing I want to think about when we're thinking about fish is people who take fish oil as a supplement. Fish oil supplements can have heavy metals in them. So you want to make sure if you're taking a fish oil supplement that you're taking one that is really pure, a really high quality fish oil supplement. And because I don't talk about supplements during this talk, and I can't endorse a company, if you want to know which one to take, email me or ask me afterwards and I'll tell you. But I can't say it on a stage. And I don't own it. Okay, let's move on and talk about some non-motor symptoms. So our non-motor symptoms are just as severe and sometimes more severe as our motor symptoms with Parkinson's. And when I'm talking about non-motor symptoms, I'm talking about nausea and vomiting, constipation, dementia, cognitive impairment, depression or anxiety, fatigue, sexual dysfunction, orthostatic hypotension, that's when you feel like you're going to pass out when you stand up, sleep dysfunction, restless leg syndrome, and pain. Our strategy with our non-motor symptoms is really to focus on inflammation. So we've got increasing brain food, decreasing inflammation, decreasing chemicals. And we've pretty much covered the decreasing chemicals. So let's talk about this decreasing inflammation piece. Inflammation is one of those big words that people throw around that nobody really knows what it is, except I do, because I'm an immunologist. This is what I work on all the time. So let's talk about what inflammation is. We think of inflammation as two major pathways coming together. The one pathway is called oxidative stress. We talked about that earlier. That's those free radicals. The other pathway is caused by a protein called cytokines. Cytokines is a new word for most people, but you've heard of hormones. Hormones are how the endocrine system communicates with itself. Cytokines are how the immune system communicates with itself. Neurotransmitters are how the nervous system communicates with itself. So cytokines are just like hormones in the endocrine system or neurotransmitters in the nervous system. Cytokines, they turn out to be important. Now, let's think about some of the non-motor symptoms that are all related to each other, and they are dementia and cognitive impairment, depression and anxiety, fatigue, and pain. They're all related. And they're related through oxidative stress and through cytokines. So, we already talked about one of the best ways to get rid of oxidative stress. It was berries, right? The darker, the better. But some of the other ways to get rid of oxidative stress are the vitamins. Vitamins are fantastic antioxidants. And which vitamins? The very first one is vitamin D. What's been shown is that 85% of Americans are deficient in vitamin D. 85% of you are deficient in vitamin D. Why? Well, a couple reasons. First is we spend a lot of time inside these days. And we don't get enough vitamin D. And if you're at a certain latitude, even if you're outside all the time, you can't get enough vitamin D. So that's one of the things. The second thing is, we made a mistake a few years ago. We said the recommended daily allowance of vitamin D was 400 milligrams. It turns out that for the average person, just sitting on the couch you will burn all day, for one day, you will burn 3,000 units of vitamin D. So 400 units is not enough if you burn 3,000 just sitting on the couch. The average person probably needs between 3,000 and 5,000 units a day, and you're probably not getting it. And most people with Parkinson's, when you put them on a vitamin D supplement, they immediately start to feel better. They start to sleep better. Their symptoms are better. Yeah. So check your vitamin D levels and start a supplement. Second vitamin that has a huge impact on inflammation is vitamin A. Again, why don't we have vitamin A these days? We've always had vitamin A. Vitamin A is in carrots and oranges, right? It's the carotenoids. So where'd our vitamin A go? Turns out that one of the things that's been happening is we've been depleting our soil. When we deplete our soil, and we're using new strains of fruits and vegetables. And when we deplete our soil and we have new strains of fruits and vegetables, we're not getting the same vitamin and mineral content in them that we used to get. Let me give you an example. An orange, 20 years ago, would contain your recommended daily allowance of vitamin A. Today, an orange is twice as large, but contains 1/8 the recommended daily allowance of vitamin A, which means you need 8 oranges to get the amount of vitamin A that you would have gotten 20 years ago. That's what's happened. And most of us are just completely unaware of it. So we're deficient in vitamin A. And again, this is one of those things your doctor can do a test, or you can just take vitamin A and take vitamin D. All right, vitamin C is the last one, and that's an easy one. You should be getting anywhere between 1,000 and 10,000 units of vitamin C a day, but most of us don't. And the nice thing with vitamin C is if you take too much, you just pee it out with all that green tea. All right, your antioxidant foods, we said berries, but also tomatoes, really good antioxidant food. And you want to really bring out the antioxidants in tomatoes? Roast them. Roasted tomatoes are fantastic for antioxidants. And then citrus. And when I say citrus, I don't just mean oranges. Grapefruits, lemons, limes, also very good for Parkinson's. And there are also antioxidant supplements that are on the market that are good for Parkinson's as well. What I would say is if you're going to take a supplement, I highly recommend that you find somebody who knows nutrition and who knows something about supplements, because there are some bad supplements out there. When I say they're bad supplements, I don't mean that the ingredients, like the ginseng, is bad. What I mean is that, I'll give you an example. The University of Chicago did a study on curcumin about 5 years ago now, and they bought 23 different brands of curcumin. They bought it from Amazon, they bought it from Costco and Walmart and Walgreens and GNC and all these different curcumin, 23 different bottles of curcumin, and they tested it, and 12 bottles didn't have any curcumin in it at all. And of the remaining 11 bottles, 6 had more lead than curcumin. So that's why I say there were 5 that were good products. And if you get a good product, it may have a great impact on oxidative stress in your body. But you want to make sure you have a good product. I don't want you having one of these products that has lead or heavy metals in it. Fats. Fats are really good for your brain. I know your cardiologist is like, no fat, but that's not true. No trans fat. Fats themselves are not bad. So fish oil is actually very good for you, as is olive oil. And olive oil is actually good for you because of its effect on blood glucose. It lowers blood glucose. Cool. And then there's another kind of oil, coconut oil. And we don't think about coconut oil very much because we think, oh, it's going to make everything taste like coconut. But it doesn't. If you get extra virgin coconut oil, it doesn't make things taste like coconut. And it has what's called medium chain triglycerides. And those medium chain triglycerides are really good for memory. And so coconut oil is being studied for Alzheimer's right now and for dementia because it has such a positive impact on the brain. All right, I told you we would talk about cytokines, so I'm going to come back to them and talk about them now. There are three cytokines that we talk about when we're talking about inflammation. The three cytokines are called interleukin-1, interleukin-6, and TNF-alpha. And we abbreviate interleukin as IL, so IL-1, IL-6, and TNF. TNF stands for tumor necrosis factor. Yes, it makes tumors die. Okay? So these are the three cytokines that are too high when we have inflammation. How are you going to remember them? You're going to remember them because you're going to go clean up on IL-1, right? IL? Oh, you're slow. Are you falling asleep on me? Okay. So turns out that these three cytokines, there's what cause fever. So if you're getting sick, they'll give you a fever. But they also do what we call sickness behaviors. Sickness behaviors. Okay, think about that. When you're getting sick, you know how you're a pain in the butt? You know how you start whining and you go, oh God, I can't get out of bed today. Oh, I feel so tired and I'm achy. You know that? You've never done that? That's just me? That's interleukin-1. So interleukin-1 makes you feel tired and malaised and depressed. And if you feel that way, it means your interleukin-1 is high. So that's how you know inflammation is going on. If you feel fatigued and malaised. And we know that people who have depression have high levels of interleukin-1, high levels of IL-1. We want to reduce that. IL-6 actually makes you feel anxious. So you know when you're getting sick and you're like, oh, I can't be sick right now. I have so much to do. I promised I would do this, and I'm taking these folks here, and I'm doing that. I can't be sick. That's IL-6. IL-6 is anxiety and stress. When you're feeling high levels of stress and anxiety, your IL-6 is high. And we know, one of the interesting things that we know, this is a study that I have a collaboration with Stanford University and that we did with Stanford, we know that it's actually different between men and women. When men feel stressed and their IL-6 goes up, when the stress ends, within 10 minutes, it goes back to normal. When women feel stressed and their IL-6 goes up, what happens, ladies? It keeps going up for the next 6 hours because women will ruminate about what if. Does that sound familiar? Yeah, I thought it did. It's one of the reasons that we know that women have higher levels of cardiovascular disease than men. It's because of their IL-6 and that anxiety response. And the IL-6 actually impacts the heart for cardiovascular disease. So you don't want to have high levels of IL-6. We want to reduce these cytokines. And then TNF-alpha. TNF-alpha is this cytokine that when you're getting sick, you sometimes become kind of nasty. You develop a short temper. You become hostile. And what your immune system is doing is it's saying, boy, we're going to make IL-1 so you stay in bed. And if you refuse to stay in bed, we're going to give you IL-6 so that you're anxious, so that you kind of like keep to yourself. But if you refuse to do that too, well, heck, then we're going to make you hostile. We're going to make it so nobody wants to be around you so you don't spread that infectious disease to anybody else. But the reality is that those cytokines are involved in all of these behaviors, whether you're sick or not. And so we want to get those down. They're also, IL-6 is your primary pain cytokine as well. So when your IL-6 is high, you experience pain. And this is why I say to my mom, you got to reduce your sugar because we want to get your IL-6 down. So how can we reduce IL-6? Well, the first thing is we can add all those foods that we were talking about earlier. We can add nuts. And when I say add nuts, the A number one nut for your brain is walnuts. Walnuts number one. Then cashews and macadamia nuts. Almonds are at the bottom. Almonds are at the bottom because almonds have good fiber, so they'll help with the constipation. But in terms of all of the things that are pro-brain, almonds don't have hardly any of them. So they're at the bottom. But You can imagine having a couple of Brazil nuts, a couple walnuts, a couple macadamia nuts, some cashews, some hazelnuts, some pistachios. You've got a whole granola there. Mmm, cool. We're also going to add berries, anthocyanins. So nuts and berries go up. Vegetables. And remember, the vegetables that we want to add are those ones with the good fiber in them. And then fish. And again, we want a clean source of fish. The other thing is spices. Spices are super good for reducing inflammation. And the three spices that we think of specifically for Parkinson's are turmeric. And actually, there's a Parkinson's drug that is going to be developed from turmeric. So you can cook with it now, though. You can make curry and use turmeric root. So turmeric is good. It'll take about 22 years for that drug to hit the market. Mm-hmm. That's the reality of drug development, but you can cook with it now. The second one is cinnamon. And cinnamon is interesting. You've got two sources of cinnamon in the world. One is from China, and the other one is from, it's called Ceylon cinnamon. You want the Ceylon cinnamon. The research on the Ceylon cinnamon was done in animals, but it showed in a Parkinson's animal model to stop the disease in its tracks. So you should start cooking with cinnamon right now. Why not? The drug, again, it'll take a while for the drug to hit the market, but you can cook with cinnamon now. You want the organic Ceylon, C-E-Y-L-O-N, Ceylon cinnamon. You can buy that off Amazon. And then the third one is rosemary. So let's all go to Scarborough Fair and buy some rosemary and make some rosemary chicken. Rosemary also shown to have really positive influence on animal models of Parkinson's. So these three spices, all spices are good, but these three spices have actually been studied in Parkinson's disease and actually have drugs that are going to come out based on the spices. Nightshade vegetables. You know what the nightshades are? Eggplant, peppers, tomatoes, potatoes. The nightshade vegetables are good for Parkinson's. Want to know why? This is a fun little fact. This is one you'll never see in Trivial Pursuit. Did you know that smoking is good for Parkinson's? You heard that? I'm not telling you to pick up cigarettes, but it turns out nicotine is actually really good for Parkinson's. And it turns out the food with the second highest level of nicotine is eggplant. Oh, the nightshades have nicotine in them. So eggplant, so don't take up smoking, eat eggplant. That's what I'm telling you. Just need to make sure that I have not convinced you all to develop lung cancer. So, nightshade vegetables. Second highest is eggplant. If you hate eggplant, go for peppers. If you can't stand peppers, go for tomatoes. And potatoes really don't have much of anything in them. So I wouldn't bother. All right, I'm ready to give you some more bad news. Here we go, some eliminations. The first thing I want you to eliminate is high fructose corn syrup. I know, there goes your soda. But here's the thing. High fructose corn syrup has two bad influences on the body. The first thing is that what it does to, well, let's do the other thing first. First thing that we'll talk about is that back in 2009, the EPA went and looked at all of the plants that make high fructose corn syrup. And what they discovered is that there were large doses of mercury that were missing from these plants. When I say large quantities of mercury, I'm talking 8 million tons per year. Where was that mercury going? Directly into the products with high fructose corn syrup. So they went to the shelves and they started pulling products, and we expected to find mercury at that point in the Coke and the Pepsi and the things that we know have high fructose corn syrup. What people didn't expect was that ketchup had mercury in it, that they found it in Quaker Oats, the little packs, peanut butter, Hershey's chocolate syrup. Yoplait yogurt. When Yoplait found out that there was mercury in their products, they went back to just using sugar. So they don't use high fructose corn syrup anymore. But that's bad. Mercury accumulates in the brain. We do not want mercury in your brain. That's not good. So, I mean, there was a huge to-do about this. You can Google it. It's all over the place. It was even on Oprah back in 2009. And the EPA gave the high fructose corn syrup plants 5 years to figure out what was going on. That was 2014, and they still haven't been able to stop getting the mercury into the products. So I don't want you to have products that have high fructose corn syrup in them. The second reason that we avoid high fructose corn syrup is what it does to your blood glucose. I told you that Parkinson's has a blood glucose misregulation component, and it does. And here's what happens. If your blood glucose starts at zero, high fructose corn syrup will take it to 100. In contrast, sugar will take it to 50. Honey and agave and maple syrup take it to 30. Stevia takes it to minus 10. So of all the sweeteners that you could use, high fructose corn syrup is the worst. So if you're just super tied to your soda, instead, get the soda from Mexico, the Mexican Cokes that come in the bottles, because they're made with sugar instead of high fructose corn syrup. And at least you get half the stimulation of your blood glucose. I don't want you to have sugar either, but if you're gonna do something, sugar is better than high fructose corn syrup. And actually, as far as sweeteners go, there was a study that came out last year looking at maple syrup for Parkinson's, and it turns out maple syrup turns on some protective genes for Parkinson's. Now again, this is one study and it was done in animals, but if you like maple syrup, use maple syrup as a sweetener instead of using sugar. Interesting thing with maple syrup though, make sure you buy the pure stuff, because if you buy maple syrup off the shelf, it's usually high fructose corn syrup sweetened with maple flavor, right? So make sure you buy the absolute pure maple syrup. Okay. So sugar, what is sugar doing? Sugar increases interleukin 6, it increases interleukin 1, and it increases TNF-alpha. So I'd rather not have you have sugar. But I'm also a realist. You're probably not gonna cut it to zero. Just see if you can remove like one sugar meal a day, or you know, have less muffins or something like that. Or try sweetening things with applesauce instead of using sugar. Much better for you, a fruit-based sugar. The last thing is, I should change this slide because then I always have people say, well, okay, so I can't have high fructose corn syrup and I can't have sugar, so I'm just gonna have Diet Coke. But guess what? Artificial sweeteners are one of the worst things for your brains. They're neurotoxins. So I don't want you to have artificial sweeteners either. No artificial sweeteners. So there's a researcher at the University of Washington named Lori Mishley, and she's been studying people with Parkinson's. She has a group of 900 people with Parkinson's now, and she follows what are called the positive deviants. I know, anytime you use the word deviant, it doesn't sound like it could ever be positive. But what that means is she's studying the people who progress very slowly with the disease versus the people who progress really quickly. And she's looking at what they do differently with their diet. And the A number one thing that happens with people who are fast progressors, artificial sweeteners. That's number one. High fructose corn syrup is number two. And number three is trans fat. So what is trans fat? Trans fat is not the fat that you find in bacon. That is not trans fat. Trans fat is the fat that manufacturers use in foods that are on the shelf that are usually baked goods. So it's usually the fat that you'll find in crackers or that you find in pre-made pies or pre-made cakes, ding-dongs and ho-hos, those sorts of things. Trans fat, probably the highest trans fat food is pre-made frosting that you buy off the shelf. So you wanna get rid of trans fats. Those are bad fats. And yes, there are trans fats in things like French fries as well, but it's actually not as much in French fries as it is in frosting. Okay, so make your own frosting. Make it with maple syrup. Okay. That might not taste very good on, and dark chocolate.
Dark chocolate.
Yeah, exactly, to mask it, right? Throw a little green tea in there too. Okay. All right. Now, most of us are not eating these individual foods. We're eating a whole diet. So I just want to finish with answering this question about, is there a diet that people with Parkinson's should do? And the types of diets that are being studied are a vegetarian diet, a ketogenic diet, I'll tell you what that is in a second, the anti-inflammatory diet, and the Mediterranean diet. Okay. The answer is, there is no one-size-fits-all approach. So let me tell you what the data says right now on whole diets. We just recently completed a diet study of the ketogenic diet for Parkinson's. Ketogenic diet is a diet that's 80% fat. 80% fat, 15% protein, and 5% carb. 80% fat. When I first heard that, I was like, that sounds like the bacon diet. Woohoo! Right? Only bacon has too much protein. It's actually not the bacon diet. In order to do a ketogenic diet, you actually have to use macadamia nut oil and avocado oil and coconut oil and all these oils, and you pour the oils onto your steak and you pour them into your coffee, and it's a lot of oil. Why would we ever do that diet? Well, the ketogenic diet was discovered in the 1920s for epilepsy. And it turned out if you put kids with epilepsy on this ketogenic diet for 6 months, permanently eliminated their epilepsy. 90% of kids who had epilepsy. The remaining 10% wound up having significantly less seizures, and their seizures weren't as severe. So you will find ketogenic diet centers pretty much at every major medical center in the United States because it's there for epilepsy. Now, about 5 years ago, people said, well, if it's good for epilepsy, is it also good for Alzheimer's and Parkinson's? Because we've got some similar brain chemistry going on there. So we've now studied it for Parkinson's in a small cohort. We did 12 people. There's been two other studies. One was a study of 7 people and another study of 12 people. What we see is roughly 30% of the people who do this diet who have Parkinson's are profoundly positively affected by ketogenic diet. 30%. Okay, so not 100%. But I don't think it's ever going to be 100% of anything, because there's also been a diet study of the vegetarian diet for Parkinson's. And roughly 30% of people with Parkinson's do better on a vegetarian diet. And they are not the same 30% who do better on a ketogenic diet, right? So what's happening is different people do better with different diets. And that means that you're going to have to experiment on your own. Try adding some oils to your diet and see if it improves your symptoms if you want to try a ketogenic. Try removing meat from your diet. And usually when you try these diets, you should try them for 1 to 2 months and see if there's any difference. If you feel a whole lot better, wow, stick with that diet. And if you don't feel better, then don't. The anti-inflammatory diet is an elimination diet, and it eliminates wheat, which some people with Parkinson's have issues with wheat and other people don't. It eliminates dairy, corn, soy, a lot of the major food groups that are GMO. And so sometimes an anti-inflammatory diet will do well for people with Parkinson's. Other times, they go and do an anti-inflammatory diet and they don't really notice a difference. So again, I would tell you, experiment on your own. Find out what your body wants. And then there's the Mediterranean diet. And the Mediterranean diet can be a healthy diet, but that's not the Mediterranean diet of the heavy pasta diet, right? This is not saying you get to have spaghetti every night. The Mediterranean diet is a diet that's high in vegetables, high in fish, in olive oil, in nuts, in berries, in tomatoes, in all of those healthy foods that we've been talking about. So if you do a healthy Mediterranean diet, you're essentially doing the diet that we talked about today. And that's a really good step one, is if you start with that sort of diet. Okay, I wanna just say a couple words about meal timing. Usually, you will hear this from your physician, and it is usually the first thing they'll tell you about your drugs. If you are on an L-DOPA drug, You should not be taking that when you're eating protein. You want to space that away from your protein. And we say 1 to 2 hours away, because a protein meal will change how that drug is absorbed. If you're not on an L-DOPA drug, then often they tell you to eat it with meals. So that's okay. But pay attention to that timing. The second thing is, there's some research that's coming out now, and actually there's been research since the 70s, but now it's really starting to apply to the brain, and it's coming out of USC, University of Southern California. And it's showing that intermittent fasting is really good for the brain. 12-hour fast. Oh my God, now she's telling me I can't eat? No, that's not what I'm telling you. The 12-hour fast is actually between dinner time and breakfast the next morning. So, if you stop eating dinner at 8 p.m., then don't eat breakfast till 8 a.m. the next morning. That 12-hour fast is important for your brain to incorporate all those nutrients and recover and reduce inflammation before you pump it full of food again. So if you can have a 12-hour fast between when you stop eating dinner and when you eat the next day, that's going to be the best thing for your brain. And that's something that's really easy for me, but I'll tell you, my boyfriend is one of those people who wakes up 3 times during the night to eat. And some people like snack all night long. They would really struggle with this. Okay, so here's our summary. Eat this. Eat berries. Eat nuts. Eat fish, green tea or caffeine, spices, tomatoes, nightshade vegetables. Eat this. Did you get it? I know somebody's taking a picture, I'm waiting. Okay. Don't eat this. I want you to take a picture of this one too. No artificial sweeteners, no trans fats, no high fructose corn syrup, and no dairy. Okay? I know, the no dairy. I hear it. Remember that every time you eat, it's an opportunity to nourish your body, so eat wisely. Okay? Now, a lot of you are thinking, oh my God, she just gave me so much information in the last hour, I'm never going to remember it. I took notes as fast as I could. I've turned this into an ebook, and so there is going to be, it's coming out this, this in May. So if you want a free advanced copy of my ebook, all you need to do is, I have a blog, it's heatherswicki.com, which is my name, or you can call 1-800-972-0335. That's my business partner. And we'll give you a free copy. If you don't get your free copy, it's going to be $2 on Amazon. I really want all these everybody to have access to this information, and it was the only way I could think of to reach people who can't get out. Because I know that a lot of people with Parkinson's are not mobile and are stuck at home. And so I really wanted to have all of you have access to this information. Okay, I think that's about it. I want to thank the American Parkinson's Disease Association of the Greater St. Louis area. And thank you all for inviting me and having me here. And I am available to answer questions now.